Hi, this is September 2022 Solar Stats Tesla Powerwall Home Energy Update for us here in the UK, along with our Tesla Model 3, Renault Zoe, etc. etc. Loads have happened this month, so stay tuned. See you in a bit. Hi, John here, and welcome. Up on screen at the moment is our schematic with all the details of our system. It's also down below in the description if you want to look in a little bit more detail. Nothing's really changed on that since previous incarnations of that. So quite a bit happened. Let's bring you up to speed with that. The Tesla Model 3, 3 years old, so it needed its MOT. It's a roadworthy test here in the UK. And went through with flying colours. I did actually have to help them a bit with how to use the controls and what have you, and how to put it into towing mode to do the brake tests and what have you, but all good. Learning curve for them and for me, so yeah, no problem there. After the MOT, I then had the return of the squeak on the control arms. I did a previous video on that. I'll link to that up there if you want to have a look at that. So that reoccurred mainly because the suspension being on its extreme drop, as it were, when it was up on the ramp. So through the app, I booked it in to Tesla, and they did a while I wait booking, and it took about an hour. So I was in the service center, which was very well equipped with coffee machine and fruit and what have you. Awesome job. They replaced both front upper control arms, left and right, and also did another recall, which I wasn't aware about, that needed doing, which was a checking on the electrical harness at the front due to potential water ingress. But again, they sorted that out. So all done on the car. It's now for the month, it's a total mileage is now 26,261 miles. Over 3 years, so not a great mileage, but still love the car. Zoe is on 28,594 miles, and for both cars you will see when we get in the spreadsheet in a minute what the monthly totals were. We've got a trip meter on the Zoe, which had been running for 1,700 miles, and our average is 4.96. It was 4.73, but it just dropped a bit with the lower temperatures. 4.69 miles per each kilowatt hour, which I'm pleased with. Here's a spreadsheet, and you can see there for September home charging we did 295.69, so 29% of that came from green or solar panels, so 58.77 there. Model 3 had 178.29, and Zoe 117.4. You can see the mileage there for each. So the Tesla Model 3 has done 1,160 miles in the month, and the Zoe 389 miles in the month. Costs there for both cars, I've split 50-50. So £9.77 for that mileage, which is effectively being the top up from using the grid to charge at home. A public charger, if you scroll along to the right there, you'll see that Zoe, we did two public charges adding 13 kilowatts. Both of those were free. And for the Tesla, we did four charges. Three of them were at superchargers. One was at an Ionity charger at Peterborough Services, which was an eye-watering 69 pence per kilowatt hour, which worked out at £13.88. The overall cost is still good, though. So the Model 3 pounds per mile is 0.02, and pounds per mile for the Zoe is 0.03. It's a screen of the Zappi, just showing you the breakdown. It was chucking down with rain when I took this photo, as you can see. Onto the eddi, which heats our hot water from surplus solar. And we've added 31 kilowatt hours this month, bringing a total to 368 for the year. This is the spreadsheet running totals, saving at 8.5 pence per kilowatt hour, which is our off-peak rate, worked out at £2.65 for those 31 kilowatts. a running total of £83.03 saved since the installation date. So what else has been happening? I've been keeping an eye on the temperatures for each room now. We have a little humidity and temperature sensor, which is linked into Home Assistant, and I've set up this dashboard so I can keep an eye on what the room temperatures are, and been working on solar gain and keeping the temperature high in the house. So here is an overview of that dashboard, so I can keep an eye on all of the main rooms, the outbuildings, downstairs and upstairs, as well as the actual outside temperature. And just to show you how effective solar gain is, this is the dining room. And at the beginning of the morning, 10 o'clock in the morning there, you can see the dining room temperature sensor was at 17.1 degrees centigrade. Sunny day. So by 18 minutes past 3 in the afternoon, it had risen to 23.4 degrees. And that's purely solar gain. And if we look at that over a slightly longer period of time, it's the same room, looking at the solar gain dropping down overnight, but some real highs there, 26 degrees again just from solar gain. So it's quite impressive the impact that makes. And I go round and open all of the shutters on the south facing side of the house to maximize that solar gain, and then that floods through the house because I have all the doors open, and it's quite surprising the difference that makes. Our investment in Ripple, the wind turbine at Craig Faffa in Wales. This is the monthly total day by day, showing you what it generated in kilowatt hours, the running accumulative, and the savings in pounds, pence per kilowatt hour each day. So an overall total for the month of £12.78. There was 4 days where the turbine was offline. So you see there on the 5th of September, there was a problem with the sensor that dealt with the positioning of the blade to actually position the pitch of the blade to get maximum efficiency. So there was a problem on that. So it was offline and it was fixed 8th of September and back online in the afternoon. So that's a day by day. This is the running total so far. So September, £12.78, bringing us an overall total of £106.63. This screen is from the website showing you what's what in terms of what we've managed to do. Let's move into closer to home and look at our solar generation. As some of you know, last month we lost our 2.34 panel array because one of the optimizers has gone out. I'm waiting for that to be fixed. We've got a 4 kilowatt array and a 2.34 kilowatt array, making 6.34, and we're only now using the 4 kilowatt array, and you really notice the difference in lack of generation. We had a few days at the beginning of September where it was working. By and large, the majority of September, we were just using the one array, and you can see the plummet there of our stats for September 2022, 363 kilowatt hours for the month, which is very poor. We know why, so that's the important thing. This is the split between the two arrays. So the yellow 334, which is the 4 kilowatt array doing the bulk of the work, and then 29 kilowatt hours from the smaller array until it went, nope, I've had enough, I'm not doing any more. In terms of the split of our overall percentage contribution to self-power, so 27% came from solar and 38% came from the battery. These are the two charts, this one and the next one, which look at the solar day by day and the converging lines, trend lines of at the bottom, later and later start of our solar day, and at the top, earlier and earlier at the end of our solar day. So look at the 30th of September, right at the end there. By 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we'd stopped generating power. It was that dark and it started at 8 in the morning. So we're certainly seeing autumn stroke winter appearing on some of the days. So this chart is our peak generation. Bear in mind that this will be the 4 kilowatt array from, you can really see where that kicks in actually. So the 5th is it was working, from the 6th onwards, just down to the single array. Again, the 30th, and we managed 1200 watt hours over there as a peak at 11:25, so odd time and low peak. Onto the Powerwall efficiency in terms of in and out. 88% round efficiency, which seems to be our sort of standard in and out at the moment for the last few times. 339 in and 298.9, almost 299 out. This is the day by day for the house. Blue is house usage, red is grid, yellow, if you can see it, is solar, and then export is in orange. Yeah, sort of tells a tale really. We've been relying on the grid a lot more this month. Our Tesla Powerwall is now on cost-saving mode. I moved it across the beginning of the month once the solar panels had decided to give out the ghost. And as a result, we are pulling a lot more from the grid because by and large, the solar isn't generating enough to fill up the Powerwall. So the Powerwall is being filled up to almost 100% every night. Plus, we're still running the kiln, one of the glass kilns overnight. The solar we're using to fill up the Tesla Powerwall again to 100%, which gets used during the course of the day, and also offsetting some into the car and heating the hot water. So it's a bit of a juggling act at the moment, trying to keep things balanced. But yeah, our grid usage has obviously risen quite considerably this month. Overall house usage is almost 900 kilowatt hours. Total there for solar, 363. And as you can see there, grid usage in red at 581, can't read, for the month. And output to the grid, 16.8. So this is our average daily house usage and average daily from the grid. So the blue line is the house usage. So around about the same, 2 kilowatt hours a day more over August and one more over July. So, you know, around about where we expect to be. But the bottom line, the red line, you can clearly see we've pulled a lot more from the grid. We're typically 19 kilowatt hours a day on average from the grid, as opposed to 4 in August and 3 in July and so on. In terms of what we sent to the grid, it's 17. That's rounded up from the previous chart when it was 16.8. From the grid, 582, as you can see. So let's have a look at our bills. This is the gas usage I pulled from the Octopus website. We haven't used gas very much, just a couple of mornings stroke evenings. This is our billing period from the 5th of September through to the 5th of October. And we've got four bars there where we've used gas. And you can see here, this is the breakdown of the costs on which days we used it. So the 27th of September, we used 20 kilowatt hours. 28th, we used 16.4. Then we skipped to the 30th, where we used 43. And then the 1st of October, we used 13.9, almost 14 kilowatt hours. And then we haven't used any more. So they're the four times that we've just popped the heating on, just to take the chill out of the air where it's dropped cool overnight and the solar gain hasn't been sufficient to keep the temperatures up in the rooms. This is our spreadsheet with all the bills on, so looks a bit complicated because we've got three lines there for our billing period in September, so the 5th of September through to the 4th of October. And the reason for that is I moved us from the flexible Octopus tariff across to the gas tracker tariff on the 15th of September. So we've got a billing period up to the 14th, and then from the 15th to the 30th, that's then the middle line, and then the bottom line is the new rates, which came in on the 1st of October. But as we're on the gas tracker, actually those rates are cheaper than the last middle billing period, but that's the benefit of being on the tracker, I guess. So that's our billing period for gas. You'll see totals in a minute. Looking at electricity, so that's that same chart but for electricity from the 5th of September through to the 5th of October, our billing period, and you can see there's some high peak usage which you already know about. This is our bills for the period. By and large, we've kept out of the peak billing time frame. A majority of our electricity usage is during off-peak. I don't know why we had two bills here. We've got one bill from the 5th of September to the 20th of September, and then one from the 21st to the 4th of October. But if you look across the two, we've got 9.7 kilowatt hours in the expensive rate billing period on the left-hand side, and then 7.3 kilowatt hours on the second part of the bill there. So a total of 17 kilowatt hours out of that overall total. So I'm very pleased with that. Now we managed to not dip into the peak rate very much. So this is our spreadsheet again, showing you the numbers. We're still on the go faster rate, 32.79 in the expensive period and 7.85 pence. That's ex-fat with a standing charge of 36 pence per day. This is our overall total. So electric bill is £72.16, made up from those two billing periods. Our gas is over those three periods, which is £15.76. Credit-wise, we had an Octopus referral come in, so thank you very much for that. And our Ripple saving of £12.78, giving us a credit of £62.78 to come off the bill, which meant we were left with £25.14 to pay. So considering the problems we had with the solar, not being able to offset that and use more grid energy as a result, I'm really pleased with the cost of that. Scrolling along in the background is the Tesla Powerwall app, so I've just left that rolling so you can have a look at the figures if you wanted to. As ever, do comment down below with your stats and figures. Do remember to like the video because that helps with the YouTube algorithm and tells YouTube it was a good video and should show to more people. So I'll see you next time. Take care. Bye.